an Episcopalian, I don't really know what "pass the faith" on the bulletin means, but I'm just going to leave it in the gospel unless I'm told to do otherwise.
Oh yeah, keep on going. Sorry.
Okay. I was waiting for some faith to be passed, but here we go. Consider this your passing of the faith. The gospel comes from the 5th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment." But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, "You fool," you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering a gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, "Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce." But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord." But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your hand, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The words of eternal life by which we have come to believe.
Thanks be to God.
So it is a delight to be here with you this morning, and it was really wonderful to be with some of you yesterday at the Cannon House. I was not prepared for such wonderful music, I have to admit. This is how worship should be all the time. So, all right, our gospel reading for today is a doozy. So let's just leap into it. And I want to leap into it sort of sideways by talking about a group of people in the early church. So in the 3rd or 4th centuries, there was a group of Christians now known to us as the Desert Fathers, who withdrew from the cities of the Roman Empire to the deserts of Syria and Egypt. They withdrew in a posture of renunciation. They were renouncing their possessions, their social status. They renounced the prospect of marrying and having a family. They believed that money and their comfortable houses and their lives of general ease were interfering with their friendship with God. So they renounced all those things, and they went into the desert to fast and live quietly. When they got there, they were distressed to find that although they had left the house, the romance, the theater, the retirement plan, though they had left those things back in the city, they were now afflicted by thoughts about them. Thoughts about loneliness, thoughts about love, thoughts about safety. They were haunted by memories of the fine meals and beautiful homes that they had left back in Alexandria. And they were plagued by fantasies that their fellow monk in the hut down the road had a better view and a more comfortable mat. So the desert monks had escaped the things themselves, but they had not escaped their own imaginations. And so they began to retrain their thoughts. The pattern that these desert monks developed for this retraining of thoughts boils down to three steps: notice, quarantine, and replace. That is, before you can stop thinking a thought, you first have to notice it. You have to notice that you're indeed stuck in a thought of anger or envy or gloom. You have to notice the story that you are telling yourself, the story that has come to seem so basic and so true that it doesn't really even seem like a story anymore. And then if you are following the desert people's pattern, after you notice this thought, intentionally set it aside. Let us say, hypothetically, that you are thinking some really ticked off thoughts about your sister, who, in her typical self-absorbed way, invited you to dinner at the dead last minute, announced that she was making Provençal stew when she knows that you hate olives, and then, when you told her that you were staying home to nurse your cold and fever, she couldn't bring herself to say, "I hope you feel better," she just said, "Fine." In this purely hypothetical example, you might notice that you are thinking something angry about your sister. And then, having noticed, you might set the thought aside, maybe just for 10 minutes. You might say, "I'm not going to think about that right now. I can come back to it in a half an hour if I want to, but right now I'm walking away from that angry thought." Notice, quarantine, and then step three, replace the thought with a prayer. Replace the thought with a prayer because disciplining our imaginations is not undertaken simply for the sake of discipline. It is undertaken for the sake of truer self-knowledge and of living more in reality than in distraction. And all of that is in turn done for the sake of creating space to attend to God. You have heard it said, "You shall not murder." But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. You have heard it said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery in his heart. Jesus sounds kind of extreme here, right? So what might it mean for us to take these sort of extreme sounding words seriously? What might it mean to take seriously the idea that your thoughts and emotions matter, and that your thoughts and emotions can themselves actually partake of sin? Well, historical precedent suggests that when you take this notion seriously, you get ridiculed, hence the title of this sermon, Ode to Jimmy Carter. I was born 3 weeks before Carter was elected to the White House, so everything I know about his 1976 presidential campaign, I know as a history lesson. I know that he used the peanut as a way of signaling that he was not a Washington insider. And I know that his victory in my home state of North Carolina, in the North Carolina primary, played a key role in getting George Wallace, finally for good, out of national politics. And of course, I know about Carter's ill-fated interview with Playboy magazine. When asked at the tail end of the interview the umpteenth question about whether his firmly held Baptist religious convictions would unduly influence his policy decisions in the White House, Carter began musing about grace and about sin, and then he quoted this morning's gospel reading. He said, "I try not to commit a deliberate sin. I recognize that I'm going to do it anyhow because I'm human and I'm tempted. And Christ has set some impossible standards for us," Carter said. "Christ said, 'I tell you that anyone who looks on a woman with lust in his heart has already committed adultery.' I've looked on a lot of women with lust. I've committed adultery in my heart many times. This is something that God recognizes I will do, and I have done it, and God forgives me for it." So before this interview, Carter had a big lead. But when choice quotations were leaked to the press, even before the interview was published, he dropped 15 points in the polls. Evangelicals and feminists were, for different reasons, horrified that Carter had spoken to Playboy in the first place. And everyone else mocked him for his piety. and his sort of lame attempt to sound like he was connecting with the common man by admitting to this lust in his heart, political cartoonists had a field day. Instead of making him seem like an average Joe, the governor's comments actually reinforced people's opinion that Carter was way too pious and way too priggish and took Jesus way too seriously. I mean, really. Confessing that you have lustful thoughts as though it were a sin, a serious sin on par with actually having an affair, please. Surely we are not supposed to take these hyperbolic and demanding things Jesus is saying about murder and lust and false witness at face value. Surely it cannot be that thinking a mean thought about someone is the equivalent of actually murdering her. Surely our thoughts, the thoughts we keep to ourselves and never talk about, much less act on, surely those thoughts are less important than our actual actions, right? And in addition to being less important than our actions, surely also those thoughts are less controllable than our actions. I can prevent myself from murdering someone that I met at a conference last week and was annoyed by, but I can't reasonably be expected or held responsible for actually feeling annoyed, right? Jesus and Jimmy Carter, and I pair the two together in the least partisan way possible, Jesus and Jimmy Carter seem to actually suggest something different. Underneath the specifics of murder and adultery and bearing false witness, Jesus seems to be suggesting that we are capable of disciplining our thoughts, at least as capable as we are of disciplining our actions. And Jesus seems to be suggesting that what happens in our thoughts and our imaginations matters. Perhaps today's gospel passage is inviting each of us to give up a thought. Consider renouncing the angry thoughts about your sister. Consider renouncing the escapist daydreams about leaving your wife and running off with your next door neighbor. Consider renouncing the jealous thoughts about your colleague at work who seems to have a better office than you have and a cozier relationship with your boss. Renounce those thoughts, because Jesus told us that they are the equivalent of murder. Renounce them to make a different kind of space in your brain for God, for charity, for love, for whatever magical and wonderful thing you might uncover if you set aside the anger and the fear. I don't, of course, know how this renouncing of a thought will work out for you, but I think we should try it before we toss it aside on that pile we all keep. You know, that pile called things Jesus says we should do, but we know no one can ever possibly do them. Reading Jesus' words over the last few weeks, it struck me that at the moment, my crazy and destructive thoughts involve not mostly anger or lust, but fear. Specifically, I've noticed that I'm having a lot of fearful thoughts about money and savings. I find myself thinking sort of neurotically about whether I am saving enough for retirement. I have started subscribing to Kiplinger's magazine. I find myself doing lots of math on the back of envelopes. So I read today's gospel, and I wonder if Jesus, looking down on high at my late night envelope scribbling, wants to say something like, Lauren, you have heard it said, do not steal, but I say to you that every time you think excessively about your retirement account, you have already stolen from your neighbor. Even just imagining Jesus saying that provokes me to want to argue back with him. Saving for retirement is responsible, I want to say to Jesus. In this totally uncertain economy, where it is every boat on its own bottom and every retiree for herself, you'd have to be a fool not to worry about your retirement. You'd have to be a fool not to obsessively check your 403b balance every night after the market's closed. Why do these thoughts matter anyway, I say to Jesus. I'm just thinking them in the privacy of my own head. What's the harm in making weekly calculations of what I need to save if I assume 28 years of retirement, a 7% return, and 3% inflation. What's the harm in indulging a little anger toward my hypothetical sister with her Provençal stew? You have heard it said, you shall not murder. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. You have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery in his heart. Harsh as these words of Jesus' sound, they are actually still part of the Sermon on the Mount. They are a small section inside of a longer speech that Jesus is giving. And that longer speech is largely about how we are to love God and how we are to love one another. And in that context, it seems that Jesus is reminding us that the thoughts we have are part and parcel of our loving or not loving. Truth to tell, I'm kind of terrified to stop obsessing about my retirement account. I fear that if I relax my vigilance, I will somehow slacken off, and then I will die cold and alone and unable to take care of myself. So why do those thoughts matter? They matter because at their core, they are about isolation. The more I obsess about my savings, the more I isolate myself and scarcify, and the more I pull myself away from my neighbors. Because my thoughts about my retirement savings are really just ciphers for another thought, that I am alone and that there will be no one to take care of me. Those thoughts, those alone thoughts, those isolate from my neighbor thoughts, those thoughts are the antithesis of Christianity. They are the opposite of Christianity. They are the antithesis of Christianity because in the Christian faith, we love one another, and we have brothers and sisters, and we don't isolate ourselves. For Christians, the kind of isolation that follows from my neurotic retirement thinking is frankly just not allowed. So the hardest thing about Jesus' words in today's gospel is not that they set a really high standard. And the hardest thing is not that Jesus sounds a little moralistic. The hardest thing about these words is that they are simple. They are so simple that they feel threatening and strange. The hardest thing about them is that they are mysterious. Jesus is telling us that not just our good deeds, but even our thoughts somehow contribute to the kingdom of God. To think a loving thought is to bring about the kingdom of God, and to think an angry thought is not. That seems mysterious to me. It seems as mysterious as God coming to earth. It seems as mysterious as God turning water into wine and healing lepers and feeding the 5,000. It seems as mysterious as God feeding us and making us his body and giving us his peace.